Happy Friday, everybody.
Oh, I feel like there's something weird going on.
There is indeed. Weird things, that is. Heard about it? Have you seen it?
Have you seen this? Have I heard about this?
We've got Justin. Justin, look at you. Did you get taller? You get a haircut?
And more handsome.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
Bigger, broader grin.
Right, bigger, broader grin. Younger yet less handsome hair.
More European.
More European.
Sure. Way more European.
Definitely less Floridian and more fake British person. There's more of that vibe going on.
You should do a... whenever you've mentioned Justin, you should do Justin's impression of you. Where it's like, I was talking to Justin the other day, and Justin was like... Hello, I am Justin.
Hip, hip, everyone. Hello, I'm Justin.
I like having just a universal horrible impression of my friends. I'm Justin. I like that Jimmy Buffett.
It's like he's here if I close my eyes.
Just... Hey, old Andrew's girlfriend came back.
I forgot about that bit.
Ex-girlfriend.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi, everybody. You guys want to do some weird things?
Yeah, ready. Ready.
Alrighty.
I noticed a couple of stories that I wanted to talk about, and I was like, I got a feeling they're going to come up.
Okay, well, let's find out.
Or not. I don't know.
One being a certain moon around Jupiter.
I don't know this.
Oh, great. Well, here, let me find the story, and I'll shepherd that one in.
It got upgraded to planet because they won the pennant, and they finally got a cardinal, and that's the rules.
They
that's
got upgraded.
Why Pluto lost the planet because they don't got no cardinal.
That's right. Now that Moon is in the Champions League, and then Pluto is in what's below Champions League?
The Participation Trophy League.
Yeah.
It's that's like right. The Winners League or something, yeah. But it's like definitely not. This is great. I'm sure the Europeans love hearing us know a lot about football.
In my defense, I also don't know anything about American sports, so I'm an equal opportunist when it comes to being dumb as a brick about sports.
I'm good whenever you are, Andrew.
Yeah, I'm good.
Too many Andrews.
Okay.
I'll go by Heaton to make things easy for everybody.
Alrighty.
We're captain.
Alrighty then, Andrew, I'll count you in for the start of the Weird Things program in 3, 2.
Hello and welcome to the Weird Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
As always, my friend.
Bryce Castillo.
As always, my compatriot.
And Andrew Heaton.
Finally. Finally, I am on Weird Things. Listeners, I'm gonna tip the deck here. I have been at every single shoot of Weird Things for the last 2.5 years. I always sit on that couch. And every time I say, can I come on the show? And they always say no. But finally, I get to be on the show. I've always been here.
It's actually a better bit than us pretending that Justin's never been on the show.
It's always been like this. Andrew always comes in doing his I've never been on the show before bit.
Maybe this week. I've been reading things about Bigfoot.
What's popping, Andrew?
Any updates on that?
Still at large. Still at large, but one day they'll get him. They'll get him.
Yeah. So, I mean, you'd be a good person to talk about this, Andrew. I talked to somebody a while ago who was pretty involved in the political space and then kind of got out of it. And why UAPs and UFOs and all that stuff is so popular.
Mm-hmm.
And his theory was that it's maybe the last safe thing you can talk about because it's not too red or blue.
You know what? I totally buy that. I'm going to give all the listeners one of my favorite conversation openers that I do in D.C., mind you, because I'm in D.C. periodically, and because I'm a twit, I go to a lot of galas and shit. Am I allowed to swear? I can't remember what the rules are.
We'll bleep it.
Okay. You go hang out at a gala, and people, first thing they'll ask you is, like, what do you do? Well, I find that question kind of boring, and I don't want to ask other people unless they're really excited about what they do. I don't really care, right? So I just ask people, what do you think about ghosts? And same kind of thing. Like, no one gets mad when you say you agree or you think ghosts exist or don't exist. Like, if I was like, hey, Andrew Main, what's your position on our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Some people are going to get offended by whatever you say. But ghosts, though, you could just have a good... I think UFOs kind of the same thing. It's not blue or red.
No, I can recall a specific conversation I had at the Magic Castle with the woman who starred in a TV show that I don't think anybody remembers on the subject of ghosts, and she and their other actress friend were like, oh, something about ghosts. And I'm like, are you guys children? And then
that's how I'm not
they were scary. Yeah, they're like, talking about ghosts. And I'm like, really? And then they were very hurt that I was so UFOs. And it's different. Like, ghosts for some people, it still has, like, particularly like growing up in South Florida, it's a religious thing for some.
Yeah, whereas the UFOs, though, I don't... Plus, like, UFOs are fun. I know I've talked to Brian about this before, but, like, can I tell you my favorite conspiracy theory, Andrew Main?
No, we don't really have time.
Okay. I insist. Objection, Your Honor. I insist.
Of course, right. Of course. So
this is my all-time... Okay, you know the conspiracy theory that the moon landing was a hoax. You've heard that before. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So here's what really happened. I'm going to tell you what really happened. We went to the moon. That really happened. Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong, and the coward who stayed in the ship and didn't walk on the moon. God. That all happened, right? But then as they were coming back, they didn't realize that the radiation would ruin all of the film, which is what happened. So what happened when they got back to Earth? Fucking faked the moon landing. Everybody wins. Everybody wins. If you think we went there, you're right. If you think we faked it, you're also correct. That's what happens. My favorite conspiracy theory. I'm a uniter, not a divider. Vote Heaton.
But you know, the funny thing is when you dig into the conspiracy theorists, the more erudite ones, so to speak, will tell you
the thinking.
Yeah, we didn't go the
theory.
First time. We did go after. They'll say the first one was fake, but then. Because you're like, well, what about like all these other successive missions and stuff that went there? And I've talked this about Brian and Jess before. Like, there are some casual debunkings that are like, oh, you couldn't have faked it. I'm like, I completely disagree. I've sat next to, you know, physicists and mathematicians at magic shows and watched them be completely baffled. And when somebody tells me, no, you can't fake this visually, I'm like, you know, hold my magic wand because
hold my invisible deck.
Yeah, because it's just like there are ways you can do this sort of stuff. But because like the one thing was like we talked about before, somebody, oh, the platters weren't large enough, film platters. It's like, yeah, you know, the people putting up spy satellites and recovering film canisters from, you know, things orbit at 22,000 miles an hour, they couldn't figure out how to solve that one.
Yeah, that was our most recent lap around this journey was there's a YouTube video where a filmmaker finally cracked it and said, you couldn't possibly have enough film to do it this way. And Andrew had a differing opinion.
Wait, do you think we faked
it? Well, I mean, yeah, because they're like, a film platter's only this big. And I'm like, okay, this is the 60s. This is when we're paying Howard Hughes $1 billion to build a ship to go recover a Soviet sub. You don't think we could make a larger film platter?
A really big plate again, that spins around?
Yeah. Like,
wait, Andrew Main, do you think we faked it?
Hell no. Of course we went.
No, you're saying the opposite.
Yeah. Lack of faith in government competency is what roots me in this one, where I'm like, yeah, I don't think they could keep their goddamn mouths shut that long. I think three can keep a secret if two are dead.
The Russians would have loved to have, you know, gone on about if it was faked. It would have been the you know, I also, trying to be a skeptic and a cynic, I have to say, like, well, that's not actually a good case to say that this is, it's like people go, people think the earth is flat. My question is like, what evidence do you have that it's round? You know, and often people say stuff like, oh, I've seen, and I'm on an airplane, I see the curvature. Like, do you? You know, like,
well, and also like the if it was faked, the Russians would have found out. It's like, so your theory hinges on Russian competency.
The Russians bought it. They were just very trusting.
Yeah.
See, okay, so aren't we planning to go back to the moon soon? Isn't that a thing? They're going to finally have somebody walk on that?
Yeah.
I think there's really good prank opportunities for this. So what they should do, not tell anybody, and I'm going to bring it right back to the beginning of our conversation, vote Heaton, is whoever walks on the moon next should absolutely get those, like, big feet things to put at the bottom of their shoes.
Oh, the springy things?
No, like those plaster prints that you use to fake Bigfoot feet.
Oh, my God.
Do that on the moon. Don't tell anybody ever. Then, like, 100 years from now, some Russian's going to be on the moon and go, holy fuck, was Bigfoot on the moon? What? We have to rewrite all the books now.
It's not bad.
Yeah. I should be hired as a prank consultant at NASA. I feel like that would be a good role for me.
Yeah. Right behind George Clooney.
Well,
yeah.
You know, I feel I have a lot in common with George Clooney, Bryce. That's a good idea.
I can see that. Yeah.
We did talk about last week that they're hiring somebody to work on, like, UAP stuff and all that, which initially I was very dismissive of. But then I'm like, well, if it's to coordinate the stuff, like, why Air Force, somebody else is doing this, fine. But I just, you know, he haven't heard me go off about that where – everybody's an expert on thermal imaging systems now.
Yeah, you actually just reminded me of a, I believe, a today or yesterday or the day before news story of not a UAP, but of a very unusual flying object and a certain 911 call. Did you read about this?
Oh, and they can't find it still?
Oh, no. I think
they found it. I know what you're talking about. Yeah, they found it.
Oh,
yeah.
They found that?
Yeah. We're talking about the
real quick, Maine, have you heard about this? I think it was South Carolina or around South that Carolina. Area. There is a 911 call of just a guy who lives in a small farm plot, and he's like, hello, there's a man here. he says that he was in a stealth F-35 aircraft and I had to eject. He's not giving a lot of details, but I think he needs help.
Oh, that's
Maverick,
great.
That was like where everybody walks into the diner, you know?
Yes.
So a pilot ejected out of his F-35. And then there was nobody in it because it was like a misfire or something. So last I heard, they were looking for where it could have gone because it was presumably in the air.
At the time of ejection, that's rock solid.
Well, there was also some chatter that some people claimed that they saw it inverted upside down, which makes me wonder how that would work with ejection. But also, like,
you get to the Earth faster.
I believe I read that some other people were claiming that the F-35 is so sophisticated that it doesn't even wait for you to pull the handle. It's like, oh no, you're in trouble. Get out. I have no idea which of this is true. And of course, the military is not in the business of giving away state secrets on this kind of stuff.
If I were the, because it landed in a farm, right?
Crashed.
Crashed in a farm. If I were that farmer, I would be like, mine now. And I would soup up my tractor and have the most weaponized, awesome $1.7 million tractor with like a turbo burner and an ejection seat.
And then you go to jail for the rest of your
life. I was about to say, yeah.
Well, I wouldn't tell anybody. I would just do it.
That's worse.
I don't think it's hard to find a crashed F-35.
Thank you, Bryce. I would also repaint it so they didn't know what it was. I'd paint it blue or something.
Your plan will get toppled by an air tag, Andrew.
the one thing that appears to be legitimate is that the guy landed in a parachute somewhere, and that farmer had to make a very awkward call to 911.
I would love to see that conversation of like, ding dong, hello, are you a Mormon? No, I'm a jet fighter. I just ejected. Okay, do you want lemonade then? You're not Mormon. You can have a drink. You want a drink? Like, let's get off the Mormon thing. Can you call 911 about the plane that I just jumped out of? All right. Is there not like a military hotline?
When we lived in Florida, there was in our neighborhood, we lived in a canal at the cul-de-sac. And if I remember correctly, some Russian sailors took a little boat to go through the canals and the boat broke down and they were in our neighbor's yard. They had to call and like wait for them to come pick them up. I'm pretty sure, I think it was Russian sailors. But so when I walked down the house, there's a bunch of like Russian sailors there. I'm like, well, this is a weird invasion.
This is the most polite Dawn ever.
Yeah, this is Red Dawn meets the mouse that roared. This is a nice, yeah.
My favorite part of the story is the fact that, I mean, this guy is a pilot, a soldier. It was rather kind of him to say, excuse me, Mr. Farmerman, do you want to call 911? And he waited until finally, like, could you hand the phone over? And he's like, hello, I was in a classified.
Code 12, another F-35 crashed in a cornfield.
Right.
God damn it, this happens all the time.
Well, imagine how jarring it must be to, like, crash into someone's farm and then be like, hey, call 911. Oh, I'll call 911. Also, what's the address here? all the friction of having to call.
It's north of town. There's not a postal address. But if you tell him turn right at the oak tree off of County Road 6.
Is that the postal address or is that a?
Yeah. My grandpa's address was north of town because he considered postal addresses an invasion of his privacy. So the post office just knew where he was, and you would just send it to Joe Heaton north of town, and they'd figure out how to get it to him.
That's how it is in a lot of other countries.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, Brian, what's new in space?
Today is the day I found out about the Big Six. Do you know about the Big Six?
Great football team, a symposium. I think that's Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, Hopkins. They got in there.
It's a different Big Six. Oh, okay. The Big Six are six elements in order to create what we think of as conventional life, including hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur, and a little gem called carbon.
Okay. All good solid elements.
The article I read was that for the first time, scientists using the James Webb telescope were able to verify that on Europa, one of our leading candidates for actual, you know, conventional life, they've detected carbon, which means we're now four out of six on that planet. Now, Europa, as we've talked about before, you know, has a giant ocean underneath it, has about 10 miles of ice up top. So if there is any life, it's going to be, you know.
It's going to be really cold. We need to send a sweater.
Or bomb it, just to be safe. Yeah. Just to be safe, I think we should bomb it.
One of those two. It'll get warm.
But
so what is that? What are the repercussions of the idea that there is carbon on there? The more that this is a likely target to be habitable for by humans?
No. This is a chance for us to see, hypothetically, and we don't expect it to be intelligent life, but actual alien life, right here in our
independently,
solar system.
There's a 10-mile ice shelf. There's definitely an impenetrable ice shelf. So theoretically, let's say we found fossil life on Mars. Actually, literally, Andrew Main joined me on a podcast on Alienating the Audience with the great Robert Zubrin, where we talked to him about this. If we found life on Mars, or we found fossil life on Mars, that does not actually tell us anything about the origin of life, because enough meteorites bounce back and forth between the Earth and Mars annually. It's a surprising amount that like a tardigrade could hitch a ride on one and go to the other. So if life is on one or on both, it very well originated on one. Whereas Europa, because it would be geothermal energy that would be powering the life there, it wouldn't be solar energy, it's too far out. And because there's that ice shelf there that would stop any debris theoretically from getting from Earth to there, far more likely that it would be independently generated life that happened separately, in which case it wouldn't have DNA like us, or it'd have separate DNA, and it would be true alien life as opposed to a Martian hitchhiker life. Mm. That's a technical term.
The challenge is going to be we'd have to establish how long was the entirety of the sphere intact. And considering the number of asteroid impacts, things like that, whatever. I think that it's much more likely, as you say, but it's one of these things where we move from this, well, if we have this, then we know. And like, we see this right now with AI. You know, what's our idea of like, what would AGI, or AGI was a term that came about because, you know, will we ever have people still doubt, well, is AI even a thing? Well,
what is AGI? Artificial General Intelligence?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, and then that's old news. The new news is artificial superintelligence, because it's like, you know, why stop at human level? But the question kind of gets into is like, you know, we used to think like, oh, well, something ever passed the Turing test. GPT-4 could pass the Turing test easily. It very easily passed the conventional Turing test, put somebody in one room, somebody in the other, and go back and forth. And with a little bit of coding and whatnot, but then people go, well, that's not the real test. And that's like with life, you'd be like, well, we found it, you know. And even on Europa, like, but do we know the shell was intact? Do we knew this? People are in space right now. And it's, I think that we'll have like, there was some Japanese researchers did a study and they said something like the potential sphere that that life from Earth could have gone to is something like 100,000 light years or something.
Right.
Some insane.
Wow. Well, that was something I learned from Andrew Main when we talked about Mars way back, is that the galaxy is not a static disk. It's moving at different speeds, right? Depending on where you are in it. And so when the asteroid hit Earth that killed off the dinosaurs, and this is a technical term, it splooged Earth pollen out into the galaxy, which is now spread around. So like we could get...
That's why they call it panspermia.
Panspermia. We could get to the other side of the galaxy and find... Like it would be radically different because there'd be millions and millions and millions of years of evolution in between us and them, but they might still have DNA. We could be a cedar planet.
Should we...
Yeah, since life started on the Earth, I think we've done something like 20 rotations or something around the galaxy.
Really?
Around the Milky Way? Wow. Done,
I got to try to find that.
On the 21st, we get a free coffee.
That's right. Only at official locations. Can't go to the airport.
Although, didn't they? Okay, I was talking to Brian Dunning about a month ago, and he was telling me that they had, I think in the 50s, they took various molecules that you would find in like pre-life Earth, so like the elements you're talking about.
Oh, you're, and then they put all the ingredients
right.
of life,
and then
life,
they electrified it. Yeah. like in a Victorian sci-fi novel, and it created proteins. Like it created the, it didn't create life, but it did create the building blocks for life, which would indicate that life is probably much more prolific.
If I remember correctly, and I'm certain Andrew May knows this better than me, but the way I remember it is that it started to create self-replicating amino acids or something like that.
Right,
but it was like close enough for government work.
Right.
Here's a hot take, right? Because that's fascinating, right? Like the impact on Earth spread biological material around the universe.
Again, I believe it was pollen splooged.
Sorry, that's right. But pronunciation's not right.
Yeah.
What if we did it again? Like, not destroy all life on Earth,
you mean,
but
like nuke Belgium just to splooge more shit into the atmosphere, hoping that we could crop dust some other planets over the next billion years.
Well, if there's a lot of talk of making humans a multiplanetary species, an interstellar species,
and Belgium sucks. Keep going.
And Belgium sucks. Wouldn't the one of the easiest things to do, or at least try, would be to shoot out biological material. So I try to simulate that in a different way. I mean, alongside more directed, you know, space missions and all. But that seems like an interesting way to also spread, if not humanity, Earth around the universe. I think I'm describing universal imperialism, but I think it's okay until we find another life form.
Well, Arthur C. Clarke is known for the quote, there are two possibilities. Either there's other life out there or we're alone. Both are equally horrifying, right? And I really was uncomfortable with that idea until I watched a certain episode of Star Trek The Next Generation that was specifically intended to explain why is it that every single alien is just a human with a weird forehead?
And they can also interbreed?
And the answer was because there was a precursor species, a universal beginning to everything. And once I thought, oh, wait, if there is no other life anywhere else, then that means we get to be the awesome precursors. And then all of a sudden I calmed down, and that seemed very cool. Now
and also,
I'm just afraid of aliens.
And also, we have a bunch of life on Earth that's not humans. I mean,
Belgians are humans.
Birds.
Really, Bryce,
I don't know why Bryce hates Belgians so much. This is kind of a weird thing Bryce is fixated on.
Can like, you apologize? Bryce does not speak for this podcast.
Thank you.
To the people of Belgium.
Yeah. So. Shout out to the Walloons. They're good people.
But think, you know, philosophically, if all if just the humans.
King Leopold, he was a jerk. Like, yeah, he was really the
awful. Okay, guy.
If all the humans vanished off of the Earth, you suddenly have this treasure trove of alien life that would be a pretty dang sparkling target for anyone else there out in the world.
Oh, hold on. So, like, if let's say humans, like, I'm sorry, we all caught the killer syphilis, and so we know humans are going to die, and so it's like we throw all of our money, all of our economic superpowers, all work together to like grab a tiger and just fling it towards Alpha Centauri, take a kangaroo and just chuck it over to Sirius.
Nice, I like this. We're gonna, yeah, we'll, like a self-drilling machine that we drop on Europa and it just drops in a dolphin. Like, go for it, dolphin.
I was thinking like bacteria.
Remember the plot of Species?
Yes, yes.
DNA. Oh no, let's put it together. Where, how could this go wrong?
That was a bit of a leap, considering we hadn't even sequenced the DNA at that time. Do you remember Species?
Oh yes. Species made an indelible market. And it was also before porn was readily available, so that was what was available.
Natasha Henstridge, yes. Inspired many a Rule 34. But the the plot was that from the Arecibo, back in the 1970s, when we sent out a message, you know, from SETI or whatever, they just sort of wrote in, also, we sent out our entire sequence of DNA. And I'm like, for many reasons, it was not plausible. That movie was...
I'm happy to talk about Natasha Henstridge naked and like somehow breeding with guys she kills and all that. But before we completely move away from the previous thing, the thing that makes me sad is if we are the precursor species, either way, if we're the precursor species or we are surrounded by other species, there's a good argument to make that it's just too damn hard to ever get to any other planet outside of our solar system. And that I think it's called the Christmas tree effect. Where, like, let's say a civilization like starts up, yay, and it lasts a billion years, but that might be off by a billion years with any other civilization. So the likelihood that we'll ever make contact with anybody is very, very low, which is a shame because I would love to do that because of Natasha Henstridge.
I have a lot of problems with the it's going to be too hard or it's too far sort of argument because, like, within. You know, we're like, imagine 19th century people trying to conceive of the stuff that we're doing today. It's really, really hard.
Yeah.
You know, it's really, and that's part of the problem too, is that we'll have these, you know, we know how to propel things close to the speed of light. Now we understand that it's an energy issue. It comes down to how much energy you want to do. But if you wanted to use phased array lasers, whatnot, you can send stuff, you can direct stuff, you can kind of send stuff all around. Like, I think that's, imagine a technology, a civilization 1,000 more years advanced than us. And I can't conceive of what that could be because I can't think of what we will be 100 years from now.
Or even right. 10
but
years.
1,000 more years. Yeah, maybe. Like, so 1,000 more years advanced to us, which is not that long. If you think back to, we talk about people from, you know, some, Andrew can probably name, you know, the royal lineage back that far. But point is, you know, we, even just 500 years back, Shakespearean times, okay? So our... We start to think about like how complicated this is to think that forward that stuff. When you think about that much abundant energy, sending stuff to other stars isn't going to be that hard. It's not going to be, doesn't have to be in the form of like spaceship Starship Enterprises, but it can just be sending in routers and internet traffic and IP stuff and whatever. So I think you can make a pretty good, and by the way, the stat is the Earth, since life has been on Earth, has been around the galaxy 14 times since life started here.
So I share your optimism, and I want...
I'm not optimistic. I'm just realistic, okay. I think. So
well, I want to make contact with an alien species, so I'm very much in favor of this. But even then, if we could get some kind of probe that we designed to go almost light speed, it's still going to take forever to get anywhere other than Alpha Centauri, right?
Like No. As a matter of fact, have you read Project Hail Mary?
I have. It's a great book.
Okay, so you remember, and there's a little bit of fudging on the energy side of things, like there's a magic super fuel, but the main character is only in a coma for, four or five years, and he wakes up, and he's completely jacked. He spends 1.5G on half of the trip and then flips around and spends 1.5G slowing down and makes it. And that doesn't seem too crazy.
And theoretically, if you built a colony ship, 4 years you could do, you know, if you had like sufficient. I mean, if you were building a long haul ship, and in Project Hail Mary, they were having to like really do it very quickly and everything. But if you were building it over 100 years, yeah. Okay.
If you get a chance, look up Phil Lubin. He's a professor at University of Santa Barbara. Really cool guy. Remember Project Starshot? That was the whole idea. The tech story short is basically, if you use phased array lasers and you hit against something like a mirror or whatever, you can actually propel things. In his research papers, he says 30% C. I asked him, well, why that limiting? It's not. He says, I just put that because that was more acceptable to people. But you can push things up to 80, 90% the speed of light. So Alpha Centauri,
things, Andrew, you don't just mean light.
Tigers.
Tigers. But I mean, like, we could take a physical object and propel it to that speed.
Space probes. Yeah, the whole thing, wow. Project Starshot was the idea of using very small probes, whatever, and using light to propel them. So you can use light to propel things to relativistic speeds. Right now, when we think about it, and it really is an engineering problem to sort of do it. It's literally just saying, well, if we want to spend $1 trillion to put in, you know, those space-based lasers to do this, we could do it. It is achievable with our scale right now. 100 years from now, extremely achievable to put. And basically, I don't think about like getting into spaceships and sending people around. I think about sending routers and probes and, you know, AIs
and stuff.
So
we could theoretically, we could design a device that we send at like 80, 90% speed of light to Alpha Centauri that already has like a preloaded probe to come back. So we could send one over there, like orbit Alpha Centauri a couple of times, then shoot it back to us with the data. I mean, it could also broadcast it by radio signal, but it would just be faster that way.
The caveat there is that slowing it down is really hard, and the idea is you could build a network basically. Like Phil's got a lot of interesting thoughts on this, and he's like legit. He's built cosmic background microwave radiation telescopes, all this sort of stuff. He's been doing great research. I really advise, if you want to do a deep dive into his papers and stuff, fascinating. And like right now he's doing government funded for like asteroid deflection. Yeah, there's the deepspace.ucsb.edu. His lab is amazing, but I'm saying it's like these things are feasible. And if we just have to get out of like, how do I build the Starship Enterprise modality and say, how do I get information from here to there?
Well, when you strip it away down to those very, very core components, you could imagine a version of, we've talked about a Dyson sphere. One of my favorite books that Andrew Main turned me onto is Pandora's Star. And it begins with a very small backyard astronomer who is just, you know, taking some photographs, and suddenly one star is just gone. And just with that moment, suddenly everybody knows a Dyson sphere is possible. It's been done and we're not alone. Like that information traveled instantly humans have to invent starships and all that stuff. That's the opening moment of everything. But I could picture, you know, if somebody, you know, you got type one, type two, type three civilizations or whatever, with enough resources, you could maybe, instead of a Dyson sphere, do a set of rotating things that essentially are basically a Wikipedia from a local star, maybe not your star, even just a beacon that just transmits fundamental truths of the universe to everyone.
We're Andrew, you were alluding to like a kind of like a network relay where you'd send out like a signal bouncer, and by doing that it wouldn't be instantaneous, but you could still do it much faster and
so you could. If you take a look at the website, you go there, look at Project Starlight. So imagine you have a big huge phased array system, you know, in our solar system that's basically using lasers to propel these things. you start sending these probes out at different places and different trajectories, because the problem is trying to slow them down. And there's ways you can actually slow it down. But basically the idea is it hits, goes towards a star, that star changes its pattern, and then it goes into another path and maybe eventually does some circuitous route around and comes back. But you could just basically create a network of moving nodes and just be gathering data and just be sending stuff and basically, you know, wire up.
Oh, that's wild. So basically a physical, all but a physical conveyor belt with a very circuitous route where there's constantly actual matter from other stars coming in and going out. To be honest, this is relevant because recently that's part of the miracle of how India was able to land on the South Pole of the moon was by they did it very, very cheaply. They were in a race with the Russians. Their craft crashed, the country of India had figured out a very, very clever orbital trajectory that ended up safely landing their craft on the South Pole of the moon.
Hmm. That's right, because they were like taking longer to get there, and so they were
and it was
much
very
much
affordable,
to,
like an order of magnitude more affordable than one might expect.
There's a lot of really cool stuff when you start getting into orbital mechanics and looking into like all the different ways in which, you know, how do you, because we get stuck on kind of thinking of 2D traditional sort of ways, like, oh, if I want to go to Mars, I just aim my spaceship at Mars and go there. Well, it's not the way it works, because you've got to aim to where it's going to be and also take advantage of transfer orbits and stuff. And it gets really complex and fascinating because you think of like, it's almost like navigating. There are places in which you can get to like super low energy transfer orbits between here and other places. You know, there's also like crazy sort of like interplay between us and like our solar system and Alpha Centauri, where one begins and what ends isn't as clean as we might think. Even in that far out distant space, there may be objects and stuff that are captured by one and then transferred to another. Mm. And, you know, we know that we have the Kuiper belt and the Oort cloud that extend way beyond. We know that there could be rogue planets. There may be some estimates put there might be just as many rogue planets as are our actual planets orbiting solar systems. And that gives you this idea of like to go from here to there, you don't even have to go to the nearest star. You might find waypoints in between here and there. And then, my point is, I think that if you look at how humans moved throughout the Pacific, and sometimes there are land bridges, sometimes there are canoes, but they just spread from island to island to place to place to place to place. You know, the only place on the planet where, you know, humans didn't end up living along any sustainable part was Antarctica. And that changed now.
Mm. Yeah, the in general, I've learned, don't bet against humans. They're very clever. Yeah. Humans and specifically prisoners. They're very, very clever, and they take a long time to think about things and come up with a solution.
No, I'm going to short humanity, the thing that you can totally do. I'm all on hamsters now. Screw humans, I'm on Team Hamster. We're going to the hamster moon, Ham Moon 2024. Moon over my hamster.
I love that you just noted yourself and then cursed yourself and then clicked a button to mark that you have to bleep the cursing that you did it yourself.
One hand doesn't know what the other is doing sometimes.
No, am I right in understanding that when, you know, they talk about slingshot around the moon or whatever, that essentially what they're doing is just by having the right trajectory, similar to, like, if you want to pivot a satellite, you just have a flywheel inside that spins around and it sort of causes, with the centripetal force, it looks somewhere else. Basically, you're, air quotes, stealing momentum and energy from the orbital spin of the various planets. Is that right? Like ever so slightly, indetectably, the planet is now moving slightly slower, but now your craft is moving faster. Is that how that works?
Yeah, I mean, I think of a figure skater pulling their arms in or putting their arms out.
Okay.
And you can use an elliptical sort of orbit to sort of capture more energy as you go to a further point. You go slower at one point, further out at another one. You know, I mean, it's really kind of like trying to wrap, your head around a lot of the mechanics of that is you realize, man, there's a term why we call people rocket scientist. You know? Hey,
Andrew, noting that none of us claim to have the ability to see 1,000 years, 100 years, or maybe even 10 years into the future, I'm curious, Brian and Andrew, is there anything that you see on the horizon in terms of our technological capacity? It could be space, it could be AI, it could be biotech or something like that, that's going to be really big that we will probably see in the next 20, 30 years that you're excited about?
Oh, yeah. AGI before the end of the decade, like we're going to have intelligence far exceeding human capabilities by the end of the decade. I'm reasonably confident in that. And it's not, we forget aliens, like what happens when you meet a super intelligent AI system that can kind of solve all the big problems we have. I think by the end of the decade, we're going to be there.
And real quick, AGI, I'm sorry, can you tell me quickly, what is the difference between that and AI? It's just a supercomputer?
AGI means artificial general intelligence, and it's a term that's used to sort of describe an AI that can kind of do anything a person can do, but more efficiently. And so instead of, you know, if you say, you know, I could basically have it process all my legal documents and it cost me 25 cents or something.
Right.
You know, it's not, you could, you know, we can, in theory, build massive, huge data centers that take up the size of a state and solve these problems. But the idea is to reduce it to the point that it makes economic sense to start using these things for. If you want to have a cancer research,
right.
You're
going to have,
say
the,
you know,
the medical side of this seems staggering because, like, most people that are working on cancer are specialists. They're not generalists, so they're going to be in a specific niche. But you could feed, like, all available data that we've got into this computer, and the computer go, well, actually, there's, I mean, it would never say this, but there's this weird correlation between pecan allergies, cancer, and, like, lobster genes. And, like, if you combine the three, and, like, it would take us forever to figure this out.
And we've reported on that in the past. I don't remember the exact details of it because it was probably over a year ago now, but Google had a thing where if you took a photo of the whites of your eyes, they would machine learning it and could tell if you had diabetes or could tell if you had
there's
some stuff like that.
Wow.
Yeah.
And but also, like, on the thing you just mentioned, Andrew, like 10 years ago, I went to a conference and they showed some researchers talked about how they looked at the Drosophila, the fruit fly genome, and they're looking at ones that were longer lived and trying to locate where and why. And they found a part on the genome that for the longer lived ones, it was associated with resveratrol, which is one of these drugs, or one of these chemicals that's associated with sort of longevity.
Right.
Maybe, maybe not. But it was a very interesting, they used an AI to look at the DNA, and that was 10 plus years ago. So these things are getting much, much better. I have a lot of kind of anecdotal experience of looking at the capabilities of systems, and these things are going to get way more complicated. You've got GPT-4 right now, Google's coming out with Gemini. This is going to continue going as these systems get more and more in life sciences. So AGI by the end of the day, and ASI, like artificial superintelligence, like systems are just way, way, way smarter than we can think of. Fusion. So, you know, I went to a presentation a week ago by the CEO of Helion, which is a company that is planning to have a net positive fusion reactor online next year.
What?
Will they succeed? They've got a contract right now with Microsoft to provide energy by 2028. Now, the thing is having fusion.
Microsoft's already given them money with the expectation that there will be an online fusion power plant by 2028. Did I understand that correctly?
They made a contract. I don't know this. I don't know the particular. It might be a funding plus whatever sort of deal. But Microsoft has said, "Hey, you know, we'll take a bet on
like
this.
Or like an exclusive option or something."
So here's the funny thing: is that you could have like next year they could turn on Polaris, and they're doing a really neat thing too, because the way it is, they have these plasma waves that go in and collide and produce energy. They're capturing the energy via electrical energy. They're not converting it into steam and doing this. It seems like I think that's a more elegant way. But anyhow, who knows? But I think that and I'll give you a really good argument for why we're probably much closer to fusion than we realize, even though people keep saying for 20 years, and I'll tell you why we were always 20 years away in a second. But if that's the case, the downside though is still our electrical grid still sucks. And they could be, you know, building these plants and whatever, but the point at which the average person on Earth is using fusion powered energy could still be decades away just because of the way things it takes to adopt stuff. But part of their plan though is how to manufacture these things at scale. Like they're designing these reactors to be able to basically put on tractor trailer trucks, you know, send 10 tractor trailer trucks to a place and be able to assemble it, have to make sure they could go under bridges and stuff. There's a lot of thought in there, but people have said, well, we're always 20 years away. And it's like, true. And for the last 60 plus years, the Department of Energy in the U.S. would not allow anybody any other agency to spend more than $20 million on a fusion project, even the Navy, because the DOE said this was our purview. And the DOE was convinced that the tokamak, the ring reactors, was the way to go forward. And so they basically killed it. Even Robert Bussard, who was originally one of the tokamak developers, the Bussard Ramjet, the guy who created that, you know, he had a Navy project, and the Navy, where they were going to give more funding, the DOE says, nope, this is our purview, go something to us. So we haven't had competing ideas. We haven't had stuff. Europe's been doing using the tokamak reactor too. And for the first time, and just starting a few years ago, we've actually had a ton of private capital. Now we've got hundreds of millions, billions of dollars going into private efforts. So we get to try different approaches. And as long as we are going to use the tokamak as the only way to do it, if it's a dead end, like, yeah, we're always going to be 20 years away. I'm convinced, I think we have a very high probability before the end of the decade of some commercial capacity for fusion.
Wow.
Do you think in our lifetime, this is the first thing I thought of when you asked, you know, what might we live to see? I'd be curious, Andrew, Maine, whether or not you believe in our lifetime we'll see AGI-powered, self-motivated robots out of Earth going about the business of, please make us nice homes all throughout our solar system.
I think as the technology advances, the AI and the design technology, the bits will follow, and we get better at moving the atoms around. As we get better at moving atoms and reorganizing them, because that's one of the biggest limitations right now, is that AI has been exciting because it's a lot easier to sort of figure out, well, I get a bunch of servers, I try a bunch of experience, I deploy something. When it comes to robots, you see Boston Dynamics, which can build these really cool looking machines, but as far as I've observed, they're not capable of doing mass production, right? And so each one that they sell is pretty much built like the prototype, and that means it's hard for them to scale, but they've got really, really good instincts about machine learning and stuff and whatnot. I think I actually had a really great conversation with the guy who was a student of the founder of Boston Dynamics, who years ago he was studying robotics, and then he wanted to also integrate art and whatnot. And his professor's like, that's silly, whatnot. And then years later, you know, the guy is heading Boston Dynamics, the students in the class, he says, I got to tell you, I was wrong. I told him this was silly. And now you look at what does Boston Dynamics do to tell people how great our robots are? Show them dancing. But I think that if we can improve, and I think AI systems can help us. Imagine we made a really good 3D printer, like a really, really good, fast, precision 3D printer. You know, then you can just try a bunch of experiments and keep going. So, yeah, absolutely. The answer is yes. We'll see this.
Brian, I'm aware that there is a group that's working on a type of automated go-kart that you would release on the moon that would scoop up the regolith and poop out bricks. So that
when we want to, we can use those bricks for whatever we want.
Because we would need them for radiation shielding and everything else. But basically, we would have like a ready supply of, like, we build our own caves or something, right? You just release it up there; it's solar powered, and it would be like a whole brick quarry available for us.
We've on this program talked a lot about the lava tubes on the moon. I would imagine that driving around and exploring those would be very useful.
Cool.
I was actually advising somebody working with a group working on one of the regular things about a way that they could use AI systems right now to dramatically increase their ability, their throughput on when they're trying to look at samples and stuff. And it illustrates like I don't know if you know, Andrew, but like I resigned from OpenAI, left 2 weeks ago because I want to create a consultancy that helps people like just get sped up on AI, because I think there's so many useful tools right now, not things that we will build, but things that are there right now that can massively increase the output and capability.
Congratulations. Would you let me know if and when you were selling stock in your company? Because I have a great deal of faith in Andrew Maine and would love to get it on the ground floor.
I appreciate your confidence. When I'm crawled up in bed at night, can't sleep, filled with anxiety about what I'm trying to do or what's next, that will be some solace.
Yeah. You call me and I'm like, hey, buddy, I got $4,000 with your name that I can invest in your company.
We're going to get a half a server, buddy. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, Andrew, it's an AI thing. Yeah, I put .a on it.
That is one of those things where I think I'm with everybody else in the country where I'm you're obviously you've been in the thick of it, right? So you're much further ahead than everybody else. But like me being like, top 30% of tech users in the country. I haven't fully grasped like ChatGPT, the implications of it yet. Like I'm still using it for fairly quotidian purposes. So I'll use it for maybe like a little bit of research. And Midjourney I've started using, which is absolutely amazing. But I'm looking at this going, okay, one, I think there's going to be a whole profession of just prompt engineers. I think that's going to be a thing of people that just know how to speak very well to ChatGPT, Midjourney, and so on and so forth. That's going to be maybe not a whole job, but it'll be a skill set in the same way that like social media is a skill set. And then I've not fully grasped what all is happening with this technology. And I'm like, I would love, like, if there were consultancy firms, if there were like tutorials or something, I would love to go, oh, I bet there's a bunch of stuff I'm doing right now that I no longer need to do. I can automate that, shoot my editor, have a robot do his job, whatever.
Bryce, I think this is abhorrent, and I would never participate in such a thing.
I was just going to let it walk by. I was just going to let it be unspoken.
I think as far as I know, I was the first person ever hired as a prompt engineer. So I was the original prompt engineer to OpenAI.
And, wow.
I remember somebody had wrote all the examples, most examples like GPT-3 and the prompt examples and all that stuff. And then when we have new models, you know, I've got to be, you know, people to go play with it. And that's in the GPT-4 paper. I'm credited for some novel model capabilities. But, the funny thing is, like, I remember somebody said, because we came out with the new models, the Instruct models. These are the ones that were actually trained to make it easier to prompt. And one of the people at OpenAI said to me, so it looks like your job's done. And I'm like, thanks. You know, I'll collect my stuff. But I'm like, I know what you're saying, but it's not like early days in 2020, prompting really was, how do I get a language model that was just a wild model trained on the wild world of internet text, whatever. How do I get it to do reliable things? And that meant like tricks like, this is not telling it. People get very literal, like, you're writing a blog post. Like, no, like, start off with a header. Start off like actually, because it never encountered that conversation where somebody told somebody else, you're a blog post and you're this, right? You know, you're the smartest coder in the world. It's like, literally, it's like, you'd say like, best rated answer for, you know, Stack Overflow on this question. Da-da. And then it give you a great answer. Like, you learn all these sort of tricks. Then we do it a thing where basically we trained it on prompt examples and outputs and really good examples and trained it how to understand what people want. It got better. But the need, as you said, this is a skill set. You're right. That's what's going. Everybody is going to want to learn how to talk to machines. Everybody's going to need to know how to talk to them, which means knowing their capabilities. You know, and I see my favorite thing is, and it's sort of petty of me, is like dunking on people and they go, oh, well, GPT-4 can't do this. Like one is like a professor wrote a thing like still can't do Wordle. I'm like, aha, you don't know how tokenization works. Let me show you. And now it does Wordle. But next generation of the system won't need me to come in and figure out some clever strategy to do it, you know, but I'll look for some new problem people say, oh, it can't do.
Well, and this is kind of in the news. OpenAI announced DALL-E 3 yesterday or the day before, and the idea being that you can access DALL-E within the ChatGPT program, but then it will do work to zhuzh up your prompts. So the idea being like they show this example of like a hedgehog with sunflowers, and it kind of remembers as you talk through, like, come up with the idea, make stickers, make this and that. And I think that speaks to what you're talking about, Andrew, in the need to know how to speak to these machines, right? You need to be able to speak whatever language it expects, even if that means there's now an intermediary layer where ChatGPT or DALL-E 3 is doing some amount of extra sprinkles.
Yeah, when you dig into how the DALL-E 3 thing works, now that I can talk about it, is in ChatGPT, when you write a prompt, it'll actually try to write and improve the prompt for you. But the model itself is, because so you're getting a GPT-4 that kind of knows how to do it. But also the model's great because the model can do text. You know, it can do other stuff. It's got much better variable binding. Really, I've got a lot of examples I'm excited to be able to share now, because it's just been sitting on those things. It was painful because it just, the quality was just so much so good now.
Yeah.
The I've found that an almost Socratic dialogue has been a lot of fun. I spent about an hour this morning asking if it could come up with metaphors to explain countably infinite numbers versus uncountably infinite numbers.
Did you tell it to limit to one sentence metaphors?
No. It did a pretty good bulleted list. I told it to help me write a children's book to explain the difference between the two. And
metaphor longer than a sentence is not a good metaphor.
It was about a sentence per thing. Awesome. Like a countably infinite number is picture a train. This is my idea. This is ChatGPT's. Is picture a train, and it's got one car, two cars, three cars, four. That is, and it goes forever and ever and ever. That's countably infinite. Now let's talk about the difference with, you know, and then after that,
what's an uncountable infinite number?
All real numbers. If you were to say one, I was like, what's between zero and one? You'd say 0.5, and I'd say, what's between those? And then it's uncountably infinite is the difference.
Got it. Okay.
Can you say that in a one-sentence metaphor?
I will if you'd let me get back to talking to Chatty G.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're keeping you.
So, Brian, let's talk about this. So you spent an hour today talking to ChatGPT.
Yes. Actually, what I was talking to was the sum total of knowledge of humans' awe that came before me. But I did so through the lens of a large language model that was able to reflect back the ideas that had come before.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is, how fascinating is it that... And I do the same thing. I'm not judging. Trust
okay,
me.
Okay, all right. I thought I was being. No. I felt a little bit judged.
There was a pregnant pause there for sure.
As an equity holder in OpenAI, I'm very glad to hear this, sir. What I'm getting at is that look at how fast things have changed. Where people can be like, literally, it used to be you'd tell Alexa a joke and go back and forth and get bored in 2 minutes, right?
Yeah.
Here. I have several windows open and I have a constantly ongoing back and forth with the system. As I solve problems, I work with it. I was trying to think of some example of how, to me, when I want to code, I'm building the thing to make it easier to make tutorials. Like to your point, Heaton, about how trying to help people, one of the things I want to do is I want to make a lot of tutorials, but the problem is taking it out of your head and putting it onto some presentable format that looks good and whatever. So I've been building a thing to do it. I've been using, like I do for everything, I use ChatGPT to do it. And I'm like, if I tried to hire a developer to build this for me, it would not come together this quickly. It just wouldn't happen. And, right. And Brian, working in the world of language and words and stuff, it's fascinating to me to think that this is so, for some of us, it's so casual and normal now.
Well, I think part of it is your base assumptions, where it's like, I assume somebody smarter than me knows more about countable numbers, infinite versus uncountable or whatever. And I bet a bunch of people have come up with metaphors. And I bet that because I'm just asking the ghosts of everyone who ever came before me, yes, there's probably some very good, simple metaphors out there.
Well, remember too that the model does a thing we call generalization, which it can learn about A and it can learn about C and can figure out B and things that haven't existed before. And that's one of the things I think that sort of gets lost is that it's got that all of that kind of compressed human knowledge in there, but also it's picked up patterns and stuff that we're not aware of. And that's the cool part is you could say, oh, I need to explain infinity, but I need to do it using an ice cream store as my example. And it will do that. It will give you examples of that never existed before. And that's what I love is I want to do this, but I'm going to give you this plus this other thing that I don't think. And that's what we know is the essence of creativity. It's just taking two or more unrelated things and combining them into something new. And it does that.
Noting that I would like to invest in your company, and I'm not trying to take any business away from my company. I'm curious, for those of us that have played around with ChatGPT but are not waist deep in it like you, is there a primer or tutorial that you would recommend that would help us kind of grasp the tools that we can use it for?
I wish I had a good, easy thing to refer you to. I think a good thing is do Google or YouTube for a thing you might be interested in doing. I picked up an ebook somebody wrote on how to use it. The problem is there's a lot of books online about how to use ChatGPT, and you can tell the author wrote 20% and then had ChatGPT write the rest of it.
Yeah.
And then it's like, because he's like, here's 100 examples. Like, yeah, I know that trick. You know, like, you know, early days open. Man, Andrew, you came up with so many examples. Yeah, I did. Yeah, I did. you know what we make here, right? You know? So yeah, there might be, I would just take a look at YouTube, look for some stuff that's highly rated, whatever, some stuff. I think there's a lot, I think there is a lot of good quality content out there. There's a lot of hype content out there. The one prompt that will 1000x your ChatGPT thing.
If I was going to just give one tip to everyone is ask for more every single time. I think you'll be very impressed with how ChatGPT, like, all right, keep going, explain more. And then, like, it really does seem to react to that pretty well.
Nice. Okay.
I think
and
one of the...
A tip, Pete, and you... One second, you could try. If you want to use it, let's say, creative writing, and people go, oh, I want to be... Like, yeah, make it. Don't let it create for you. Let it be your writing partner asking you questions. Like, and you can say, hey, I want to write a story. Ask me questions about the story, my characters, et cetera, whatever. And I will give you the details, but and I've got a prompt. I'll try to jig it up. I can share it with you, which is basically like this, like 10-point prompt that you end up with an outline at the end with character development, all this other stuff. But you supply that, and unless you don't want to, you can say, "Hey, you take over for me and do this." But it's like sitting there with a really good writing teacher that says, "Okay, what's it about? What's the conflict? What's going on here?"
Yeah, and I think that's going to be a big shift as we see more and more different usages of AI. And like, I do a lot of video stuff. There's not a lot of AI things I can use at the moment. But the thing that will be interesting to see in the long term is if this leads to people being more creative or not, right? Because you go to ChatGPT and either you have an idea and you want it to help you, or you're short of an idea and you want it to spur something in you. I've found in the little bits that I've used ChatGPT, it is very helpful to know what you want out of it. And I think there's also a lot of exploratory use of AI right now where people are just trying it out, seeing what happens. But I wonder what that'll overall do. I mean, I don't think necessarily will be dumbed down, but it really helps knowing what you want, and that is not something that is easy for creative or non-creative people to do.
Subjectively, I guess objectively, not everyone has experience being a manager, and not everybody has worked with a writer's room. But subjectively, talking to ChatGPT feels an awful lot like that. Like just having a writer's room, where you're like, let's talk about this. Explain it. Like, no, more like this. No, that's dumb. Don't ever say that again.
Automate the writers I work with on sketch comedy. This is even better than shooting my editor. Eventually, I'll be able
to. You already can do that right now, and you should hire a certain new company that I know about to help explain to you how to do it.
But I have found that you have to have that. You have to have you have to have something in yourself for it, because a lot of the times what it generates is fine. It's fine.
Right.
But not great. But especially if you're talking about sketch comedy or literature, like it'll be great for a first pass. But when you read a lot of it, you're like, this is very generic and not interesting in a way that I would hope something I was in.
Well, at least with comedy, that is part of the process, right? So I just did a writer's room brainstorming session in New York 2 weekends back. Where we were working on sketch comedy, and everybody was instructed, bring 5 ideas. They don't have to be good ideas. They just have to be ideas. And you throw it out there, and you're like, this is a horrible idea. And it probably is a horrible idea. But everybody goes like, you know what? It would be kind of funny if we did this. Hmm. And then somebody else goes, oh, yeah. What if it was a puppet? Always getting to the puppet bit. Mm-hmm. So I can see ChatGPT doing that kind of thing where it's just giving you grist for the mill, and you're like, that's a dumb idea, robot. But if we took that dumb idea and turned it into a puppet, then yeah.
I took when I was playing around at GPT-4 and early, it was frustrating because having this before, you know, working on trying to find examples and stuff before the thing's announced, one was like, you know, the 6-word science fiction stories and stuff, having it do that and knock it out of the park and being so tempted to send that in to places and do that. But my favorite example was, I would give it articles from today's news and say, can you write jokes for its talk show host? And I had like three out of five of the ones that it came up with, I watched the next night be told by talk show. It was amazing. It was
That's amazing.
Do you think that's because the AI was that good?
Yes.
Or do you think that the teams have figured out they can use AI and that they were literally getting
no,
the
they weren't using notes. I was the only one using GPT-4 for this. Okay. I was the only one that had access to this. It's just that they're not that imaginative.
Well, so I've been saying for a while that that's going to happen because I think that like I don't think that you're going to get I think creative professions are probably safer than anything else when it comes to this stuff.
But
with like joke writing, I could totally see a late night room. They're just being like the guy whose job it is to look at the 400 jokes that ChatGPT wrote based on headlines that day and going, okay, these 15 are pretty good, right? Like you're not going to get rid of all of the comedians, but it would be very helpful if you're like Rishi Sunak fell down some stairs, write 50 jokes about that. And you're like, yeah, that was pretty good. And like, you know, giving you a jumping thing, giving you a like some raw material you can sculpt from there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and people are using it now. They're just not, there are people on the picket lines who are using this now, but they're not telling people that they're using it. That's been a big thing, is just the stealth adoption among, because I know when I talk to people in the creative industries and, you know, I have had a lot of interactions with people, very high levels and different levels and stuff like there. The number ones are very enthusiastic about it, but not publicly enthusiastic about it because of the backlash. And then there are a lot of people in writers' rooms who've been using this stuff. Let's see. I'm trying, like, write some late night. Just grabbed a thing from a news site about a politician, the mayor of Dallas, switching to Republican. Write some late night jokes about this.
I would like to hear these. Yeah, like do this.
I said, write some late night jokes about this. Here we go. Dallas Mayor Eric Johnson announced he's leaving the Democratic Party for the GOP. That's right. In a move that shocked everyone, he revealed that he reads the Wall Street Journal. When asked why he switched to the Republican Party, Mayor John said, American cities need Republicans, which New York City replied, wait, are you offering a trade?
These are like, I can think of at least one late night show that this is better than.
Yeah.
Only one.
Let's see.
And then these are, you know, these are jumping off points. Dallas, like you can juice these up.
Dallas Mayor Johnson said his op-ed, as America cities go, so goes America. And as any Dallas Cowboys fan will tell you, so goes the first half of the season, so goes the second, maybe next year.
That might just be, I don't know, sports. That one doesn't do much
for me. I know. Well,
I guess all of our pick is ChatGPT.
But yeah, so anyway, yeah, you can see like these are like, it gives you a bunch of them. Like you could grab a couple from there, but like I had, you know, some of the stuff that just was public fears limits. So I was like, wow, this was like, yeah. And like, you know, and there are comedians that go like, I got nothing to worry about. Like, I don't know. Let's look at a transcript from a writer's room. And then you tell me that everything that pops out of everybody's mouth is gold.
I'm going to channel the man that I'm sitting in for this week, Justin Robert Young, who's brought up, I think, accurately that writers don't have anything to worry about, but hacks do. I think if you're a hack, you probably do have a lot to worry about. If you were recycling trite ideas on a regular basis and you're doing conventional pedestrian plots or boilerplate jokes, yeah, you probably, yeah, mm-hmm. you get automated, but all right, I'm not, to be blunt, that's sympathetic. I want you to try harder. Be smarter. Be more creative.
Here's the problem, Andrew. I don't know
I'm
about
a hack.
You.
Fuck!
No!
I'm saying that's my fear is that, you know, we all deal with imposter syndrome and creatives. And like I had somebody on Twitter who was really vitriolic when I was talking about Jolly 3. And he's like, I'm a writer. It's going to put writers out of work. And it's like, well, I don't, you know, I'm a writer that's primarily made my living as a writer. Like, I don't think I should be a protected class.
Yeah.
You know, I think if Kubota, whatever, has some new robot that can manufacture something and I'm buying products with it, then yeah, I don't think I'm more entitled to my profession than anybody else is. But other people, you know, but also I do feel like I think we're going to have a creative golden age. I think it's going to be an amazing time to be a creator.
I'm with you.
Creator.
I do a, like, on my sci-fi program, I have a segment where my friend Nick and I do sketches where we go to the planet Vulcan and we do stand-up comedy. We tell what it's like doing comedy on Vulcan. So it's a very sci-fi, jokey type thing. We go to Quonos or we'll, you know, whatever. So I recently put these up on YouTube and I went on Midjourney to make the image for it, because I would put the image up
thumbnail
the podcast and then just have a little wave file there. And one of my friends was like, you know, you really should have hired an artist. And I was like, to do 42 unique images for something that's just a fun project that's not monetized, I wasn't going to do that. I'm not going to pay like $1,000 to do these thumbnails on what is essentially just a hobbyist playlist on my YouTube. So I didn't take a job from anybody. It was just that I have now art available to me that otherwise would not exist in this world.
And if there was somebody you could pay $20 a month to just handle that, automate that for you, just choose some prompt. Like there is actually an entire new class of creative that's possible where it's like, okay. Because I say like, a middle school can't afford an on-staff artist to create bespoke images and lesson plans because it takes too much time. But they could afford an on-staff generative AI person to go in there and handle the needs of a lot of people. It's just the scale. The idea that like for a thing that's disposable that I want to get paid an outsized amount for, then we choose not to do it, like podcast art, et cetera. But, the thumbnail, by the way, the YouTube thumbnails, like Mr. Beast says, they spend like 60% of their time or 70% of their time on the thumbnail as they do on the production of the video. Like thumbnails is an entire, like there's, you look up the people who are now the trained thumbnail experts who know what to do. And like, there is now a huge demand for people. It's not the actual making the art. It's knowing what the F to put in there.
Yeah.
The new meta is closed mouth. It used to be open mouth, but now it's closed mouth.
Yep.
The paradigm shift that I experienced was realizing that the job of the writer, this can't be original to me, but I had the thought, the job of the writer is not to write. The job of the writer is to be the first reader. You know, Stephen King dreams every single night, and he dreams awful nonsense stories, but he is the first reader, and he knows which parts are garbage and which parts deserve to be developed and eventually become something. Likewise, GPT hallucinates on command and brings wildly disparate ideas together, but it's the job of the author to be the first reader.
Do you want to hear a ChatGPT generated Vulcan comedy routine joke?
Yes. Would love to hear this. Yes.
It's a baseline. I recently attempted to watch human comedy. They seem to find humor in knock knock jokes. Let me attempt one. Knock knock.
Who's there?
Who's there?
Logical.
Logical who?
Who? Logical, you should have known the punchline.
This sounds... Wow, that's pretty good. Also, very much what I would expect Vulcan humor to be.
I don't think I'm getting my two drinks worth out of this.
I say we wrap this one up.
I'm going to need a drink
ticket. Put a bow on it.
Finally, to those who say Vulcans have no sense of humor, I'd like to point out that we invented intergalactic chess. It's a game where if you make a wrong move, you might lose a planet. If that's not comedic brilliance, I don't know what is.
That is literally what I think the carrot top of Vulcan would say. I think brilliant.
Andrew, is there anything you'd like to promote?
Yeah. You know what? Given the audience that you've assembled and the topics you have, I will point you all to my sci-fi podcast, Alienating the Audience, which both Andrew Main and Brian Brushwood have been on multiple times. And if you just want the funny stuff, Andrew was bringing up with the Vulcan jokes, you can go to mightyheaton.com/vagabonding, and it will take you to all of those sketches that I do with my friend Nick on various worlds, and you can get yourself some sci-fi comedy.
I'm very curious to have this dude. If this is some ChatGPT prompting for you, Vulcan comedy routine in the style of Jerry Seinfeld.
This sounds amazing. This is what I'm doing with the rest of my day now. Thank you, Andrew.
Any picks? Anybody else?
No, I think we all picked ChatGPT.
yeah, ChatGPT for the win. And there's other tools out there, but it's my friends built that, so I'm very proud of it. But big fan. So you got twice the Andrew, ladies and gentlemen, for the show. Plus your Bryce, press your Brian, and really you just came out ahead as opposed to any other formula we could have had. So it's been weird.
Thank you. All right, that'll do it for the Weird Things show, everybody.
Yeah.
We're going to do some After Things.
My wife brought me a burrito in the middle of this, which is delightful.
I thought that was the purple drink that you were drinking. I thought that was it.
That too, and a burrito.
I was actually going to ask, Wallace is getting a little fidgety. Like, would it be the worst thing on the planet to take a brief hiatus? Because we have to shoot ads and some other stuff.
Go for it. All good. All good. Yeah, no problem.
For After Things? Okay. All right. Yep. Right on.
Oh, okay. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Just skip one week.
I see. We never call it a hiatus, and so I didn't realize.
Oh, yeah. No, I didn't mean end the show.
All right. So I'm going to take the dog out. Hey, yeah. Andrew, nice to see you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So no show today, right?
After things.
Cool. All right.
Okay.
That's what I'm proposing. Yes. Yes.
And all right.
Okay.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us here on the Weird Things program. Patreon.com/weirdthings, of course, where you can go and support us at any time. Thank you, everybody. Have a good rest of your Friday and weekend. Bye-bye!
Bye-bye!